Teach your neighbors that I have been healed.
Oh, Lord.
I have been healed. Look at your neighbors that I have been healed.
I have been healed.
Even if I don't know it.
Even if I don't know it.
If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Galatians. We'll be in Galatians 6, verses 7 through 10. I've already been asked, why is there food, whatever you call it, breaker-upper as I call it, a juicer, maker, a blender, whatever you want to call it. I've asked why we used apples last week and oranges this week. We gonna have smoothies for Jesus. Amen. Amen. We're excited about what God is doing. We're in the book of Galatians 6 through 7 through 9. It says, be not deceived, God is not mocked. Amen. For whatsoever a man soweth, thou shalt he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are the household of faith. This morning we continue our series, it's harvest time. Amen. This series is all about reaping and sowing. What I mean is this series is all about making life choices, right? Me and my wife, we don't have a lot of people over our house. I don't know why, we're just weird. But we were excited yesterday. It was a big football game on that a great team won. We don't have to go there or anything like that. You know what I'm talking about. If you're saved, you know where you're at. But anyway, we had a big game yesterday. Me and my wife said, hey, you know what we're going to do? We're going to make a life choice. We're going to invite our associate pastor, Jeff Lyles, and his wife, Nicole Lyles, and they're in Brooklyn over to the house, and they can have a play date, and we can watch the ball game. That was a great life choice. They came over to the house, and it was awesome, but me and Sherry never prepared for just four or five people there. So you know what we did? We went out and bought 40 chicken strips. And we told Sister Nicole, and this Sister Nicole, I don't guess she prepared, because she brought a whole bucket full of meatballs. And last night, my wife made a decision of putting all that in baggies as you leave. I'm just kidding. But we had all this chicken and all this, and we had a three-year-old and a two-year-old running through the house, and we didn't get much watching on the game, but it was kids running everywhere, and it was just an awesome and great time, and it came to me and hit me. Listen, the choices that we make can affect if we're happy or if we're sad. It can affect what's going on in our life. And listen, even the smallest little choice can change everything in your life.
Amen.
Smallest choice can change everything. And this whole series has been based on a book written by John Lawrence called Life Choices. And we've been looking at the seven laws of the harvest. And we've already been through four of them. Let me update you. The first one was we reap much that we did not sow. These oranges came from a tree that I did not plant. Amen. But I get to reap what somebody else sowed. Amen. Just like in our life, salvation has nothing to do with what you did, but it has everything to do with what Jesus did. You didn't have to put in the work for salvation. All you had to do is come back and give your life to Him. And when you do that, you get to reap what was sown. We also said we reap in the same kind as we sow, which means if you sow to the flesh, you'll be dominated by sin. But if you sow to the Spirit, you'll be dominated by the Holy Spirit. Amen. The third thing, the third law that we said in the harvest was we reap in a different season than we sow. Which means that planting and harvest occur in different seasons. I thank God for you that are here today, because you know what? You don't know this, but you're sowing a seed right now. Amen. You're sowing a seed. You might have a grandchild, a child, a family member that's lost, but you know what? You're sowing a seed because you came to church this morning. You, listen, some of you say, we see healing is here, but I'm sick. I'm having a hard time. We said freedom is here, and well, I'm having a hard time. I'm being burdened down. You know what? The first seed you can sow, you stand up and say, I'm Instead of for the victory, we would already feel the victory.
Amen.
I pray in the victory. Amen. Even when I'm down, I pray in the victory. Amen. Because I know God's already got me. And I'm not trying to say I'm cocky, but I know that God has already got me. He's already in store. He's already prepared a victory. All I have to do is keep my eyes on Him. The fourth thing, the fourth law, is we reap more than we sow. Which means small seeds produce huge crops. Amen. That means something small that you start now will produce something bigger in your life as long as you allow it to, as long as you give it to God. And listen, we said the same thing happens with sin. A small sin can lead to a whirlwind of destruction, but a small prayer, a small praise, a small giving your life to God can restore a great crop in your life. Something small can make something big. This morning we're going to look at law 5 of the harvest. And that is, we reap in proportion as we sow. Some of you might think that this contradicts law 4. But that is not true, because law 4 concerns God's part, while this law concerns our part. You see, the word proportion means the size, the shape, or the extent of something, or a balance of arrangement. So whatever you put into something is what you get out of it. Amen. Did you realize that? Tristan, when I was in high school, man, I was small. I don't know what happened. I was skinny. I was only like 120, 130 pounds. And I was happy about that. So we'd go into the weight room, and you know what we do? I was the offensive lineman, which didn't make any sense for me being that small. But I would have to work out with the big guys. I mean, the big guys. Like 300-pound guys. And you know I couldn't lift none of that stuff. And I didn't even act like I could lift none of that stuff. So you know what I did? I went to the weight room, and I said, because I can't lift that, you know what I know? I'm not going to put a lot into it. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to have fun with it. So I'd get up there, and I'd joke around, and then boom, I'd fall down, and I'd say, ha-ha, I can't lift anything. And they'd say, okay, and then they'd start lifting. But you know what I found out very quickly? Because I didn't put enough in that, when it came to a time where I had to go against one of those guys, guess what happened? I fail every time. Some of us wonder why we keep being defeated by the devil. Have you prepared? Have you put in the time, put in the work? Have you put, listen, some of us say, why ain't God saving? Listen, God can save in a minute, but when's the last time we put the work into it? When's the last time we prayed? Amen. When's the last time we praised? When's the last time we worshiped? When's the last time we gave God all the glory and all the praise and all the honor? Listen, I know some of you sing some of these songs and you say, Bobby, I don't even know the song. But you know what? If you begin to let the song go into your heart, I don't know why, Brother Gonzalez, I come to realize this. But congregational singing is one thing, but praise and worship is another thing. Because see, when we come into the house, it's great when we can all sing a song, sing it together. But I come to realize this, instead of just singing it, why won't we let it just come into our life? Amen. When we sing, I can even take an old blue hymn, Everybody Will Be Happy Over There. If you sing Everybody Will Be Happy Over There with a frown on your face, you're not living out what you sing. What are you putting in it? Amen. Whatever you put in it is what you're going to get out of it. And church, we've got to realize that. I heard one pastor explain it like this. If a farmer only cultivates 1 acre, he can only reap what 1 acre can produce. 2 Corinthians 9:6 says, But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Paul tells us that big sowing leads to big reaping. Amen. Here, I want to explain this a little bit better. In the book, the author, Lawrence, he begins to say this and explain it a little bit. He says, if you want to be rich, give. What? If you want to be rich, give. Amen. Now, I don't want to make this all about money, because then you're going to look at me and say, that pastor, all he cares about is my money. I don't care about your money. I care about it, but I want you to have money. Amen. But I also want you to be able to give back to God. And I come to realize this. Sometimes when we don't give back to God, then we can't expect the God to give us the blessings that he has in store.
Right.
Amen. Listen, I had to learn that the hard way. You know, sometimes to make money, you got to spend money. Amen. Amen. You never see somebody walk into a store and they say, here's $10. Amen. That would be nice, right? If you get your job could be you just walk around and people just give you money, right? That would be great. But you know what? Sometimes you have to buy the product and then sell the product, because if you don't buy the product, you have nothing to sell. So listen, church, if you want to be rich, start giving. Amen. Not just that though. It don't just go into money. It goes into other things in your life. If you want to be poor, then grasp a hold of something. If you want abundance, then scatter. Amen. Listen. If you've only been witnessing to somebody that already comes to church, then you better start scattering your seeds a little bit more. Amen. I'm going to look at my wife because I'm probably going to get in trouble with her. We worry about so many people on the inside of the walls, we forget about those on the outside of the walls. So we're not scattering our seeds. You know what we're doing? We just keep giving our seed to the same people, the same people. And listen, that don't mean we shouldn't be there to help each other and pick each other up. But you know what I mean? If we still just scatter seeds with each other, how are we going to ever reach a bigger harvest? Amen. How are we going to reach to something bigger than we've ever seen before? If you want to be needy, then hoard. You see, church, if we sow abundantly to the Spirit, we'll reap abundantly in spiritual blessings and consequences. But if we sow abundantly to the flesh, we will reap an abundant harvest of consequences of fleshly living, or a life full of weeds of unrighteousness. David proves this point. You see, because David continued to sow to the flesh, his sin began to snowball. It continued to get bigger and bigger. He went from coveting Bathsheba to one sin after another sin until he broke every sin of the second half of the Ten Commandments. Whatever you put into it is what you're going to get out of it. Whatever you put into it is what you're going to get out of it. The Bible talks about this in a negative way, but he also talks about it in a positive way. You see, this is a spiritual law of life that is inherited in the nature of God, but one that is contrary to the nature of man. And because of this, God encourages us through a number of passages to live as children of God according to his laws and his promises that we put into something, then we'll get back. What I mean is that the Word of God wants us to know that the increase comes from God, but the effort comes from us. Listen to this. I love it. 1 Corinthians 3, 6-8 says, he said, I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Amen. Amen. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither is he that watereth, but God gave the increase. Now he that planted and he that watered are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. Listen, you will receive the reward according to your own labor, but God will provide the increase. Amen. Listen, you can't make anything grow. Amen. I wish I could make stuff grow. Listen, I thought it was funny. Me and my wife, man, we're so excited. We bought pumpkins, right? And I done told you, we're not farmers at our house. Everything dies. And we brought a pumpkin home, and we sat it on our front porch. Now, you don't have to water a pumpkin that's not on a vine anymore. You don't have to give it anything. You just sit it there, and we didn't even cut it. We just sat it on our front porch. That bad boy is dying. We had it on our porch for 2 days, and that thing said, oh, I'm dead. It is rotting from the outside, and it is falling apart. And I'm like, really? This pumpkin not even that old. It's just falling apart. But God has shown me, listen, it doesn't matter what I do, I can't provide the growth. But you know what's so great about it? If I put the effort in it, God will provide it. Amen. The reason why churches are falling apart is because nobody wants to put in the effort. I don't know if y'all know this, the church has to be clean. Somebody has to put in the effort, right? The grass has to be cut. Somebody has to put in the effort, right? You see, when you put in the effort, God blesses the effort and He provides the increase. Amen. When we put in what we need to put in, God will provide the increase. And church, we must realize whatever we put in is what we're going to get out of it. This is the truth in every area of our Christian life. You see, God's divine essence, His character, forms the foundation and the motivation for operating by this principle in life. We need to remember who God is, what He is like, what He has promised. What I mean is that not only is He all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-present, and sovereign, but He is loving, He is kind, He is gracious, and He is a giving God. And it is God's nature to bless and give the increase. John 3:16 and 17, we all know this. We all love it. It says, for God, amen, we can just quote it like it ain't nothing. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. But I like 17. You know what I like 17 about? It says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Listen. When we give our lives to God, Brother G., God says, listen, I'll give you more than just freedom. I'll give you more than just healing. I'll give you everlasting life. And listen, we put in the effort. We follow the commandments. We get closer to God. We seek Him. We praise Him. We give Him all the honor. And when we do that, you know what He does? He blesses us. He helps us. When we're sick, He has a helping hand that is right there. When we fall, He's there to pick us back up. When we're in the storm, He said, peace, be still. And the waves stop, the troubles stop, things stop. And church, if we would just realize, if you put in a little bit of effort, God will bless us and He will provide a big growth inside of us.
Amen.
He'll provide something better than we ever thought we could ever have. God is who He is. We can expect God to be generous with us. Romans 8:32 makes this point. He says, he that spareth not his own son, but delivered him up for all of us, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. God has greater things in store than we could ever think about. We just got to put in some effort. It is sad that we don't get in this position anymore. It is sad that we keep looking down. Listen, looking down has no effort. You can hang your head all day long. But looking up at the Creator and the Savior and the King of Kings, that provides a little effort. That provides a little muscle. That provides a little tension in your neck. And if you look up at Him, He says, if you put in the effort, I will provide the blessings. I will provide the increase. I will make sure that nothing small will stay small for long. I will make it big. I will make it greater. I'll make all things great. The Bible says that we will receive our reward according to our own labor. Which means if we must sow abundantly, sowing abundantly is the result of the outward working of biblical insight, values, commitment, and the Spirit-filled life. You see, church, instead of talking the talk, we need to go out and do what we talk. The Bible calls us in James, He says, don't be just listeners of the word, but be doers of the word. Amen. You know what that means? If the word tells us not to do something, then we don't do it. But if He tells us to go out, that's what we do. We go out. If He tells us to praise, guess what we do? We praise. If He tells us to pray, guess what we do? We pray. If He tells us to worship, guess what we do? We worship. Because we follow Him. We follow Him. The best example I can give us of this law comes from Jesus in Luke 6. Verse 31 says, as He would that men should do to you, do ye also to them likewise. Then Jesus spoke about love, doing well, your enemies, lending, being merciful and not judging. And then he applied all of this to Luke 6 and 38. And I want you to listen to this real quick. He says, give it, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measures, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give it to your bosom. For with the same measure that ye might with it, it shall be measured to you again. See, Jesus was talking about if we love people, it shows who we are. If we give to people, it shows who we are. But you know, I got to thinking about it as we've been talking about the harvest. Listen, I love oranges, man. Oranges are great. Oranges are awesome and great. I can eat oranges all day long, as long as somebody already peels them. I hate peeling them. Amen. I know some of you saying you don't like putting in the work. No, I don't like getting the orange stuff under my fingernails. It's just horrible. But I got to thinking about this a little. The more you put into something, the more you get out of something. So, as he was talking, I got to thinking, if we would worship a little bit more, if we would love a little bit more, if we would pray a little bit more, if we'd give a little bit more, and so on, what can God do? What can he do in our life? Because the law of the harvest says that, yeah, he can make small things big, but the law of the harvest says the more you put in it, the bigger you get. Amen. I told my wife to do two, and then she got here, I told her to do four. So, I got to thinking about that a lot. Thank you. And I got to say, listen, it's great and awesome, because the more you put in it, the more you get. The Bible says, I love it. Can you pull up that last scripture? Michael, Brother Short. It says, give it, and it shall be given unto you. In good measures, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You see, when you give it to God, he presses it down. He shakes it together, and he said, listen, I love it. Shall men give it to their bosoms, for with the same measure, amen, with the same measure, it shall be measured to you again. Amen. As you can tell, we didn't practice this at home. We had a small seed that was sown. That small seed provided a tree, and when that tree grew, it provided fruit. One seed provided fruit. All these oranges probably came from just one or two seeds. But then when we put the effort in, we put a little praise, we put a little love, we put all this in there, guess what happens? He puts it together, he shakes it together, and you know what happens? It says it overflows. Listen, church. Don't stop your worship, because God's got something greater in store. Don't stop your praise, because God has got something greater in store. And listen, it might look like a bunch of junk right now, but praise be to God, when somebody's thirsty, they come to the well. And guess what? When they come to the well, now because we have an overflowing spirit, we have an overflowing baptism of the Holy Ghost, guess what? it don't just affect us now. It affects every single person that we come in contact with. Because now they see the water that's flowing out of you. It's not water that makes them thirsty. It is water that they'll never have to thirst again. Because it's the living water. It's the water that comes from Jesus Christ. It comes from the well that we've never seen before. And as we continue to press it down, as we continue to give, God will continue to overflow our spirits. He'll overflow our hearts. He'll continue to move in our lives. Church, the more you put into it, the more you'll get out of it. Because God is the God of increase. He's the God of greater things. He's not just the God of judgment. He's the God of love. And not just any kind of love. He loves you so much that He gave the most precious gift that He ever gave. And that gift is Jesus Christ. His everlasting life. But you must put in the effort. Healing is here. Healing is here. Freedom is here. Freedom is here. Listen, when we think about healing, we just think about sick people. You know what I think about? I think people that are far from Christ. One of the greatest sicknesses in this world is people that are far from Christ. That have a heart issue. That has an issue where they've got sin inside their heart and they don't have the Holy Spirit inside of them. And listen, I'm not judging you because I'm the same way. Every single morning I wake up and I have to ask God to forgive me. This week, I want to let you know, this week has just been crazy. It has been one of the most eye-opening week I've ever had in my life. Tuesday night, I sat down and I told my wife things I've never told her before of things that were going inside in my life. And as I began to tell her, God kept telling me, healing is here. Freedom is here. If you put in the effort, I've already provided the victory. I've already provided the increase. I just need to see somebody stand up and give it to me. Somebody to pray a little louder. Somebody to praise a little wilder. Somebody just to give their whole heart to me. And I will provide the increase. One person can change the whole world. As long as they get their lives in the right spot and put in the effort. Listen, I've told you many, many times, I believe this church is going for greater things. And I want to let you know, if you just look, Sister Marilyn and Brother Jesse, we were talking about this Tuesday morning. We started this back in June. We started praying for every single one of these pews on Tuesday. I don't know if you know that. And we don't just pray, we pray. I mean, we ask God just to wipe the person out living on these pews, right? Just get all, just let them know that the Spirit of God's here. And you know what? We are going to start praying for this side a little bit more. I don't know why, but this side is not. This side is booming. Man. Whoever's been praying on this side needs to go over here. But we've been praying. And you know what? A small little prayer because somebody put the effort in. You know what it started doing? Bigger and greater things. Sister Whitney, Sister Sherry, I'm going to ask the whole praise team, though. If you're out here, come on. If you can. I know some of you got babies that you're holding different things. That's fine. But whoever can come up, come on up. Amen. Here, after we have this altar call, we've got some people that are putting in the effort and coming and becoming a part of this church at Restoration Chapel. I'm so excited about it. If I'm not mistaken, last I count was 8. If 8 don't show up, don't blame me. I'm just kidding, I'm joking. But some people, as I talked to them during the membership class, I told them that God still has greater things in store. He's got greater things in store. And listen, I don't know why this is hitting me. If you walk through the back door and you have a pass, that doesn't mean that God doesn't see the effort that you came in the store. I don't know why you're here. You might be here just to be here with somebody. You might just showed up. That's fine. But you came through the back door, so you made some kind of effort, and God will produce an increase as long as you allow it. Some of you, it was a struggle to get here this morning. Some of you are dealing with emotional things. Some of you are dealing with physical things. Some of you are dealing with family issues. And some of you just dealing with yourself. Like yourself just keeps getting in the way. Myself keeps getting in the way all the time. And I have to say, self, man, that's how I talk to myself sometimes. Get out of the way. Amen. But you know what? You made the effort. You showed up this morning. showed up, God wants to provide an increase in your life. But you just got to realize healing is here.
Amen.
Freedom is here. Amen. The presence of God is here. A couple little oranges. Do you know that if you go buy orange juice at the store, you know what happens? It takes about, if I'm not mistaken, about 30 to 40 oranges to fill up a cart of oranges. But you know what's so great about it? What they do is they take it, crush it together, mix it up, pour it in a cup, and it'll provide an overflow. Just keep pouring. God wants to pour into your life this morning, but you have to put in the effort. Might as well stand.
I don't know why you came here this morning, but I know God's got something greater in store for each and every one of us. 10, 12 years ago, I put in the effort and said, God, change me, and He changed me forever. Three years ago, God put something in my heart, and I said, God, I don't know if I can do it. He said, if you put in the effort, I will provide the increase. Listen, even if you don't think you can do it, God can still provide an increase as long as you put in the effort.
Amen.
If you love Him, He will love you back. If you allow Him to come into your heart, He'll change you forever. But you've got to come down and say, God, forgive me of sowing to this flesh. God, I want to sow to the Spirit. And how do I sow to the Spirit? I ask you to come into my life and take complete control of me. Change me. Use me. And just, God, I know I'm not perfect. I'll never be perfect. But I know that I can give you what I have and you'll make greater things in store. Just give it to God. Every head bowed.